Good morning and welcome to the morning Bible study. And I'm going to just read one verse out of chapter 2. And I know I don't want you to think I'm belaboring this point, but actually two verses. This is where God is telling Adam that he can eat freely of the fruit of any tree in the garden. Verse 17, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat that fruit, you're sure to die. Now, I didn't mention this in our yesterday's study, but obviously the geography of the garden had changed. I think with the flood, there'd be a tremendous change in the way things were. None of these rivers are located where Adam describes them. So that's something that would have changed. I just want to mention that so you wouldn't be wondering, well, how come those rivers don't have their headwaters there in a place, one place? And that's because those things have changed. Those names, I think, were just simply applied to other rivers later on. Now, when we look at this verse with the knowledge of good and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, we've already talked about the fact that this has a judicial quality. But I want to talk about the ties of this tree to our baptism. And to do that, we need to first of all be looking at what would really be considered the primary covenant in Scripture. And I know that may sound odd because to us, and rightfully so, the primary covenant is the one that's established with God in Jesus Christ. And that's true. However, what we need to understand is that that primary covenant is actually the realization of an earlier covenant. So everything that happened before Jesus' life and ministry was looking forward to that. And there was a covenant that was made that Jesus actually fulfills. And that would be the covenant made with Abraham. Now, there's three parts to that covenant, you might say. We're going to be jumping ahead. So Genesis 12, Abram, before he's called Abraham, was told that he would be a great nation, that he would be a blessing and he would be famous. He would be a blessing to others, that those who bless him would be blessed. Those who curse him would be cursed, that he's a blessing to the whole earth. Now, there's another covenant, same covenant, but it's further amplified or described in Genesis 15. But I'm going to jump ahead to 17, where God says that Abraham should serve him faithfully and blamelessly. He would have countless descendants. He's commanded to obey the terms of the covenant. It's an everlasting covenant, he's told, that many nations and kings would come from his line, and that circumcision was the sign of the covenant. Now, between those two, in Genesis 15, we have this very interesting story where Yahweh makes covenant with Abram. And I'm going to jump up here. And it's interesting because Abram believes the promise of a seed, but he has trouble believing the promise of the land being given him. So let's look here in chapter 15, verse 7. Then the Lord told him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land as your possession. But Abram replied, O sovereign Lord, how can I be sure that I will actually possess it? The Lord told him, bring me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old female goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. So Abram presented all these things to him and killed them. Then he cut each animal down the middle and laid the halves side by side. He did not, however, cut the birds in half. And then he goes on to talk about the whole process there. So this Genesis 15 account, there's only one other place that this is mentioned in the Bible, this idea of cutting the covenant. We do have some information from the ancient world that this was a practice. But I want to read to you from Jeremiah 34, 17 and 22, through 22, I should say. And this was when the Babylonians were laying siege to Jerusalem, and Zedekiah was king, and Jeremiah was the prophet of God at that point. And he had brought this word about the enslaving of their countrymen, and so they made a covenant. We're going to let our countrymen go free. Now, verse 17 of Jeremiah 34, therefore, this is what the Lord says, since you have not obeyed me by setting your countrymen free, I will set you free to be destroyed by war, disease, and famine. You'll be an object of horror to all the nations of the earth because you have broken the terms of our covenant. I will cut you apart just as you cut apart the calf when you walk between its halves to solemnize your vows. Yes, I will cut you apart. Whether you are officials of Judah or Jerusalem, court officials, priests, common people, for you have broken your oath. And we'll stop with that right there. In fact, I'm going to come back and we'll continue this discussion tomorrow because I'm trying to keep these fairly short within the confines of about 3 to 5 minutes. So keep these things in mind. We will be back again tomorrow.